A very good evening to all of you. Today from the AOSIN Web Academy, we have a very eminent speaker talking on a very interesting and difficult topic. We have Dr. Bijoy Thomas, who is a professor of neuroradiology at Sri Chitra Thirunal Institute of Medical Sciences and Technology. Sir has also done a fellowship in pediatric neuroradiology from SickKids, and he is particularly interested in genetic and metabolic diseases of children. He will be talking about on brainstem and beyond, genetic basis of imaging pediatric hindbrain pathologies. I must also add that neuroradiology is not the only thing Dr. Bijoy is an expert at. He is an expert artist, as you can see. You will not believe that he's not a trained artist. He'll be showing you a lot of his paintings, I'm sure, in his presentation. And he also has a very good sense of humor. So we are in for a big treat from him. So over to Bijoy, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Suhasini, for this invitation and also for AOSIN for inviting me to this platform. And happy Doctors' Day. We have a few more hours left to celebrate that. And I hope and pray that all of you are actually keeping safe in these unusual times. Today, we will talk about brainstem and some of the genetic basis of main pathologies which we are commonly encountering. And these are my disclosures. And if you see these three brainstems in pediatric patients, the first one shows that if you casually see the sagittal images, everything looks normal. But if you see very carefully, the pons is almost, the height of the pons is almost the same as that of the midbrain and the medulla. And normally pons should be at least 1.5 to 2 times the height of medulla and the midbrain, which are almost of equal height usually. And this is not normal. So the pons is almost same height as that of the medulla as well as the midbrain. And if you come to the cerebellar vermis, it is almost okay because it is extending from the intercollicular line to the orbex. But the corpus callosum is, even though if you look very casually, it looks normal, but it is not normal. The isthmic thinning is not complete because the body and the isthmus are all of almost of the same width, which is not normal. The rostrum may not be completely formed, but it is equivocal. But posterior part of the callosum has got a sharp angulation downwards. And if you see the second second case, the corpus callosum is thin. It is again having a sharp posterior angulation. The brainstem is entirely abnormal because the brainstem is very thin. And the pons, again, the pons of medullary differentiation is not clear. And the pons usually will have a belly, and pons should be bigger than medulla. Here, the medulla appears to be bigger or lower than pons. And if you look at the vermis, cerebellar vermis is significantly hyperplastic. And if you see the supratendural brain parenchyma is also abnormal. If you see the third image, the corpus callosum is entirely abnormal. Brainstem is significantly abnormal. The cerebellar vermis is abnormal. The vestigium is pointing down. The anterior callosum is deficient. And the rest of the callosum is showing a 90-degree slope. And posteriorly, again, there is a sharp angulation down. Anterior cingulate gyrus is missing. The radial patterning of the frontal gyri. And this is totally abnormal brainstem. If you see, the first one is actually most likely a Dyne C1H1 mutation. And the second is a tube A1A mutation. And third is an ACTA2 mutation. So the first one is a microtubule associated protein dysfunction. Second is a tubulinopathy. And third is an arteriopathy. So the mid-sagittal image itself, you can actually give suggestions that what is the mutational abnormality which we are actually looking at. I'm not telling that you can actually detect all these mutations from the mid-sagittal image itself in all cases. But this is what currently imaging can actually do. With the advancements of molecular biology and imaging techniques, especially MR imaging, I think a lot of advancement have been made in the recent past. Previously, the infratendural structures were not given as much importance as the supratendural structures because basically people thought that supratendural anomalies are more important. But the posterior fossa visualization was not that very clear. With the advancement in the high resolution MR imaging capabilities, now we can see very, very minute structures of the posterior fossa. And that's why more and more interest probably in the last 1.5 decades, a lot of interest has actually happened in posterior fossa anomalies. And today we will be quickly review the anatomy and the embryology of the hindbrain in relevant to which is relevant to genetic base of imaging pathology. I will not discuss all the anomalies. It will be a case-based approach that will be more interesting for us. And I will not discuss cystic malformations of the posterior fossa like the Blake's pouch cyst or Dandy Walker malformations, which itself is actually a separate topic. So if you look at this 2009 article from Barkovich, which gives a comprehensive classification of these posterior fossa anomalies. But you see that this is almost 11-year-old paper, but at that time many anomalies were not known. But this classification actually takes care of future possible anomalies, because in the mice and all, they have experimentally found out different malformations are possible. Not all of them are actually described in human subjects, but they have given a classification system which a future anomalies which are described in the future also can be accommodated in that.
So there is a request for increasing the volume. Suddenly it has become a little softer. It was okay when it started, but it's okay. A little bit
okay. Can you hear now?
Yeah, much better.
Yeah. So so if you see that the previously I was talking about the Barkovich 2009 brain paper, which gave a comprehensive classification. So in order to understand the brain pathologies, you have to we should know about what is happening in embryology in the brain development. In the by the age of 4 to 5 weeks, then continuing up to 8 to 12 weeks, in the case of posterior fossa, you can see that the development of the from the neural tube, there are three vesicles which are developing initially, like the prosencephalon, mesencephalon, and the rhombencephalon, and two flexures, the cephalic as well as the cervical flexures. And we will not talk anything about prosencephalon today. We will be talking about mostly about the hindbrain and also some certain aspects of midbrain anomalies as well. So from the diencephalic mesencephalic junction and from the mesencephalon to the rhombencephalic junction, and there are these cleavages are happening, and there are different signaling pathways which are important in actually development of the brain. And when this brain develops in the craniocaudal or the rostrocaudal pattern and or the anterior posterior pattern in the embryo, so everything is the same. So it is called the anterior posterior patterning. So when the brain develops into prosencephalon, diencephalon, mesencephalon, rhombencephalon, the rhombencephalon again divides into rostral metencephalon and the caudal myelencephalon. So from mesencephalon, the midbrain develops from the caudal and the cranial or a rostral part of the rhombencephalon, which separates into metencephalon, both the pons as well as the cerebellum develops, and from the myelencephalon, your medulla oblongata develops. So, like I've told, different signaling pathways like FGF8, fibroblast growth factor 8 and 17, and EN1, PAX2, OTX, GBX, everything is important in the anterior posterior patterning or the craniocaudal patterning. And in addition, brain is also developing in radially perpendicular to this direction with this axonal migration, proliferation, and all. This is called the ventrodorsal or dorso-ventral patterning. And different signaling pathways are important in that. So when we go back to the cerebellum development, it starts from 4 to 5 weeks and then continues even post-natally. So probably slightly, you can see that the cerebellum develops from the uppermost cranialmost part of the metencephalon, from which the both cerebellum as well as pons and pontine nuclei develop, like I've told previously. So in the uppermost part, dorsal as well as the cranial part of this metencephalon, initially a rhombic lip develops. And from the rhombic lip, you can also see there will be two separate germinal matrix zones, which are actually developing into the future cerebellum. From the medial ventricular zone, the GABAergic fibers, especially the Purkinje cell layer fibers, migrate radially to the outside, the already formed cerebellar anelage from the rhombic lip, and radially on the influence of several signaling pathways, including the wind pathway to the outside, especially the Purkinje cell layer, as well as some of the supporting cell layers are actually developing like this. At the same time, the lateral part of the ventricular zone and the proximal part of the rhombic lip, the rhombomere 1 cells, especially the glutaminergic external granular cell precursor cell, external granular precursor cell actually migrates tangentially. So if you look at the cross section, they are actually these two cells are actually not separated far away initially by 4 to 5 to up to 8 weeks probably, and this migration is tangential, and this Purkinje cell migration is actually in the radial fashion. After this is migrated by another probably 20 weeks or so, there will be again the secondary germinal zones developing, like the external granular layer. The granular cell precursor layer first migrates tangentially to form the external granular layer. Then later in the development, external granular layer proliferates, and it proliferates, it acts as a secondary germinal zone, and then it actually migrates inwards radially again, not tangentially this time, and pass through this Purkinje cell layer or the molecular layer, and it goes inside guided by the sonic hedgehog pathway, which is actually secreted by this Purkinje cell layer. So there is a constant interaction and a different signaling which is happening. And the sonic hedgehog pathway is actually helping this external granular cell grow inside and form the internal granular cell layer, which proliferates much more higher after 20 weeks of gestation. So this is happening before 20 weeks of gestation. After 20 weeks of gestation, the internal granular cell layer proliferates much faster, and they form the highest number of neurons anywhere in the brain. So this is a paper from Neurographics in 2017, and this is Joseph Wolpe's paper in 2009. And you can see this is very well depicted, the same thing, which is from the ventricular zone, the medial ventricular zone and the lateral rhombic lip, and how these layers are actually formed and how these signaling pathways are important. So in addition, the basic brain development, we know that there will be cell proliferation, migration, axonal pathfinding, and then the post-migrational differentiation. All these things are happening. All these things are also happening in the cerebellum, and all these pathways which are actually specifically involved in this migration, axonal pathfinding. For example, we'll be very much interested in the tubulin pathways, as well as the reelin pathway, as well as the Robo3 pathway, which I will discuss in the subsequent slides. So if you see that the cerebellum continues to develop from 20 weeks, probably postnatally of the first 2 years of life, where the external granular cell layer then becomes thinned out, and the cerebellum is actually undergoing multiple rotations and forming the final shape. And the number of granule cell layer, like told, in the internal granular cell layer is about 10 raised to 11, and it is exceeds the total number of neurons in the entire cerebral cortex by fourfold. So the granular cell layer, these are also neuron cells of the cerebellum, they are much higher, at least 4 times higher in number compared to neurons in the human the forebrain. But because they are very thin and they are tightly packed, the cerebellum is very small. Otherwise, cerebellum would have been much larger, and this hairstyle would have never gone out of fashion, and the bike helmets would have looked like this. But because these neurons are packed in a very small space, why we need to know this embryology in this detail is because we can see several developmental tumors. For example, the classical example is a medulloblastoma. You can see that the medulloblastoma, there is nothing called medulloblast cells from these tumors are developing. Medulloblastoma is not a uniform tumor. They are actually different tumors. So from this paper in 2014, by the location, you can actually, that the medulloblastomas are basically classified in 2016 WHO classification, or a modification of the classification into sonic hedgehog, wind subtype, as well as the group 3 and group 4. So for example, from the location itself, you can see probably predict that this is a wind pathway medulloblastoma, and in the cerebellar hemisphere, it's a sonic hedgehog pathway medulloblastoma. I have discussed about how these external granular cell layer is actually migrating back radially into the cerebellar hemisphere under the influence of sonic hedgehog, and further the insults in the subsequent development on the sonic hedgehog pathway, these medulloblastomas, these subtypes of medulloblastomas are actually going into the cerebellar hemisphere. So everything has got an embryological basis, and the Wnt pathway, like I tell. All these things got interest very recently. And when we talked about the rhombohmia 1, from the rhombohmia 2 to 8, from the lower part of the rhombic lips, these things are actually finally developing into the pontine nuclei. So these are not contributing to the cerebellar development. They are actually migrating from this rhombic lip anteriorly, again going into the brainstem. So this is the heat map, which is again from that AJNR paper. You can see that depending on the location, you can differentiate from these tumors. So again, from the rhombohmia 2 to 8, these tumors are, this pathway is actually helping in actually getting the pontine nuclei organized, which is arising dorsally and then migrates ventrally into the brainstem. So if you see that this is basically supported by the Wnt pathway, and this Wnt pathway subsequent mutations and the tumor development, the Wnt pathway medulloblastomas occur in the cerebellar pontine angle. So they will never happen in the cerebellar hemispheres or in the midbrain. Even when they are classified as midbrain, if you carefully see that they will be off midline and they will be going more towards the brainstem or in this cerebellar pontine angle or along the line of the foramen fleshca or lateral recess. So strictly speaking, these medulloblastomas, the Wnt pathway medulloblastoma, which has got the best prognosis, especially in children, they got 90% as 5-year survival rate. So that's why their de-escalation therapy is actually advised for these tumors. So they are never a cerebellar tumor. They are mostly developmentally more related to the brainstem than cerebellum. That's why medulloblastoma is a misnomer, and they are actually different type of tumors. So as you are all neurologists, not that much interested in medulloblastomas, we will talk about some neurological conditions now. So now coming to the normal anatomy, we talked about embryology. Now normal anatomy is also very important. So when you start reading an MRI, I think you should always look at the mid-sagittal image. Most of the radiologists will be looking at the mid-sagittal image as actually a topogram. But if you carefully see, we can actually find out many things. Like I've previously told, if you look at the absolute measurements are not very important postnatally. They are important in the morphometry in the antenatal period, especially the fetal ultrasound and fetal MRI. But absolute measurements may not be important. But if you look at the midbrain and the medulla, should be almost equal in length or height. But the pons should be at least 1.5 to 2 times the height of the medulla as well as the midbrain. So that is normal anatomy. And if you see that the cerebellar vermis, that is also very important. Cerebellar vermis, there is a primary fissure, which is developing later in the development. Then there is a prepyramidal fissure. So this is occurring around more than 20-25 weeks. I don't remember exactly which week it develops, and even 19-inch MRI, you can actually detect that, and cerebellar development can actually be slightly delayed compared to forebrain development. So the non-appearance of this thing, you have to give some allowance that it may develop later, rather than actually telling that all the cerebellum is abnormal antenatally if you scan before 25-26 weeks of gestation. So this is the primary fissure, and this is the primary pyramidal fissure. Then you can see these different lobules, lingula, central lobule, and culmen. And between culmen and the declive, you see this primary fissure. Declive folium tuber, and after the tuber, before the pyramid, is a prepyramidal fissure, and then the postpyramidal fissure, pyramid, uvula, and nodulus. Of these lobules, the DFT will be the smallest. That orientation is very important. Again, if you look at the extent of the cerebellar vermis should extend normally from the inferior, this is the superior colliculus, this is the inferior colliculus, of the tectum, and this is cerebellar vermis should extend from the superior colliculus to the inferior the intercollicular line, not to the superior colliculus, intercollicular line, to the level of the apex, which is at the level of the outer outflow tract of the fourth ventricle. So at level of the apex it should extend. That is the normal anatomy. Again, if you draw a line which is from the inferior colliculus to the apex, or you can see along the floor of the fourth ventricle, it should be a straight line, and the vestigium or the vestigial point underneath this is the roof of the fourth ventricle, underneath the vestigial nucleus lies, should be exactly at the mid point, intersect at the midpoint of this line, and it should be slightly below the superior inferior midpoint of the pons. These are normal anatomy. So this normal anatomy is very important. Even though it looks very silly, this anatomy is very important. Any slight variations, you can actually predict probable genetic mutation, that is the vestigial point, primary fissure, and prepyramidal fissure again. So for example, what happens in this this nomenclature is very important. This the cerebellar folia are prominent. There is some foliar atrophy. The cerebellar vermin atrophy is there. It extends from the superior intercollicular line superiorly, but inferiorly it is not extending up to the apex. So I thought there is an inferior vermin hypoplasia. But the problem is that when there is atrophy, it is very difficult to predict whether there is associated hypoplasia as well. But you should not get confused between these terminologies. So there can be hypodysplasia, or there can be atrophy. Atrophy is always an acquired pathology. There can be a genetic base of that too. For example, this case, which is supplied by Dr. Sneha Sudhakar from Ghosh, she has actually shown that this is an INAD, infantile neuroaxonal dystrophy, because you can see the clavel hypertrophy and cerebellar atrophy. On follow-up, the cerebellar atrophy continues. So as the cerebellum atrophies, the superior inferior extent or the height also comes down. So when we don't know whether there was an this is just an atrophy. So in this case, it is proved, unless we have a serial follow-up, it will be very difficult to predict whether there was a hypoplasia itself initially. So that is one point you should remember. This is infantile neuroaxonal dystrophy. You can see this is the clavum. Clavum is nothing but the gracile tubercle under which you see this the gracile nucleus lies. So in infantile neuroaxonal dystrophy with probably due to a PLAN mutation, and you can see the basal ganglia mineralization, the progressive cerebellar atrophy, especially the vermin atrophy, and if you see this clavel hypertrophy, this is not clivus, this is clavum, which is Latin means it's club, it is club shaped. So this is infantile neuroaxonal dystrophy due to a PLAN mutation. So I told about different pathways, especially the FGF8, 17, fibrovascular growth factor, and there is something called isthmic organizer, which is actually acting as an organizer for the development of the brainstem, especially the midbrain and the pons. And the different factors like GBX and OTX2 are expressed, and the relative expression of OTX2 and GBX2 determines the relative height of these pons and medulla as well as midbrain. So I told that if you look at these things, you can actually predict minute mutational changes, but it sometimes there can be a significant phenotypic overlap as well. So when you look at this brainstem again, like I've told in the second case, this brainstem is abnormal. The pons is actually bigger, and the medullary pons differentiation is not good. Cerebellar vermis is abnormal. Whenever you see this, you should immediately look at the tectum as well as look at this. Sometimes there can be tectal hypertrophy, and look at the corpus callosum. Corpus callosum, there can be thinning, there can be dysgenesis of the corpus callosum or the commissural agenesis. Or there can be supratendural abnormalities. For example, this is Sednik syndrome, and we will talk about. So whenever you see midbrain, hindbrain malformation, you know that the posterior fossa malformation may not be in isolation. They can always be associated with supratendural anomalies. You should definitely look at the head circumference of the baby, whether this is, that should be clinically measured and should be provided to the radiologist. And because this head circumference is very important, especially especially to differentiate between tubulinopathies and macrotubule associated protein abnormalities, whether the set circumference is below 3 standard deviations or between 2 standard deviations and normal. So the brainstem, cerebellum, we looked at corpus callosum, basal ganglia is very important structure. Look at the ventricles and white matter and the cortical malformations, and in some cases other systemic anomalies are also important. We talk about the tubulinopathies and microtubule associated anomalies. So what are microtubules? The microtubules are actually, if you look at the eukaryotic cytoskeleton, the cytoskeleton is actually supported by three types of tubules or filamental structures. These are the microtubules, the actin filaments, and the intermediate filaments, of which microtubules are the largest. They are in microns or in daltons in size, but they are the largest. And if you see these are actually forming the cytoskeleton. They are very important in the neuronal mitosis, axonal migration, axonal pathfinding, as well as axonal intra-axonal transport. So what happens in the human brain, there are different microtubulins are there, and these the from alpha to zeta, I think six or seven ones are, six microtubules are actually described, of which we are interested in the alpha tubulin as well as the beta and the gamma tubulin. In the gamma tubulin ring structure, alpha and beta tubulin heterodimers are actually forming. Constantly they are forming and they are getting destroyed or redesigned. This is called a dynamic instability. So these tubules are actually getting formed and they are getting destroyed, and this is again formed depending on the different signaling pathways, and is a very, very intricate mechanism. Actually, everything is genetically determined, and it's actually through these signaling proteins, all these things are constantly happening in our cell, especially in the developing brain. So then what are microtubule associated proteins? With these tubular structures which will help in these all these functions, then there are cargo proteins which are actually getting attached to these tubules, which actually help in actually transporting the cargo along these tubules. There are different microtubule associated proteins like LIS1, DCX, which are very important in development of Lissence cephaly spectrum disorders like kinesin and dynein. Everything is, we told about the dynein C1H1 mutation, which is actually a dynein pathway mutation. So dynein is actually carrying things to the positive side of the tubule and the kinesin the opposite side. So this, even though we know many things about these things, and many things we don't know, and I think more and more of these proteins and signaling pathways are getting identified. So this is a very interesting paper from American Journal of Neuroradiology, published in 2016, again from Barkowitz group. You can see that these tubules, the microtubules, are important in the neuronal proliferation, then the axonal pathfinding, and the intra-axonal transport, and the abnormalities of which can produce diseases called tubulinopathies. There are several different tubulinopathies described, of which the commonest one are 2B1A and B2B. And in this particular case, the second case which I've shown in the first slide, you can see that the brainstem is abnormal because the proliferation, the neuronal proliferation is abnormal, and because axonal pathfinding is abnormal, because the proliferation is abnormal, brainstem is actually thinned out. The cerebellum is, worm is also very small, hypoplastic. It is not extending from the intracollicular line to the apex, so it is hypoplastic, and the brainstem has got an abnormal shape. The pons and the medulla is not, it's actually a showing the normal ratios. That is because the axonal pathfinding is different, and all these things are different. Again, you can see, if you see carefully the cerebellum, there is multiple small cystic changes are seen. So if you see microcysts in the cerebellum, you'll immediately think of congenital muscular dystrophy, Walker-Warburg syndrome, and all. So, but this is because again, supratentorially, you see there is an abnormal cortical formation, ventricles are dilated. And what is the abnormality here? It is looking more like a cobblestone Lissence cephaly, what was previously called a type 2 Lissence cephaly. And again, if you see this, if you see all these things, everything can come in congenital muscular dystrophy. But this patient has got a no muscular dystrophy, and this patient has got developmental delay, significant seizures, and this is the tubal neuropathy. So one of the tubal neuropathies, tube A1A mutation, can produce cerebellar microsis. There are other things which are also can produce this, which I will discuss. These cysts are actually not true cysts. They're actually because the pyelimiting lamina or membrane is deficient, because there is an overexpression and the post-migrational overexpression. And you can see that the proliferation is actually happening, and the migration is actually not limited by the pia. It's actually going beyond the pia. That's why is this cobblestone lysis encephaly, which is classically seen in congenital muscular dystrophy, but also can be seen in some tubal neuropathies. So especially these cerebellar cysts are most commonly and classically described with the tube A1A mutation. So these cysts are not true cysts, because these cysts are actually produced by invagination of this pile limiting laminae, and this is also a representation or a similar thing which is happening in the supratendural structure is happening in the cerebellum as well. So there can be polymicrogyria associated with the tubal neuropathies. There can be many other anomalies associated, and because both polymicrogyria as well as Lys encephaly type 2 or a cobblestone Lys encephaly, both are actually post-migrational events, and all these things can happen. So these are the described, some of the described tubal neuropathies, tube A1A, B2B, which are the common ones. And if you strongly suspect a tubal neuropathy, if you write tube A1A or B2B, most of the time you will be right, because other things are much rarer compared to tube A1A, B2B. And you can see that the other abnormality, because there can be significant microcephaly, they will form significant microcephaly because the neuronal proliferation is abnormal. It is not enough proliferation is not happening. The brainstem will be abnormal, cerebellar vermis will be abnormal, and the tectum will be slightly thicker. That's also another finding. Because the neuronal formation is deficient and the pathfinding is deficient, there can be significant white matter abnormality, paucity of the white matter, the anterior limb of the internal capsule is not very well formed, there is fusion of the striatum, and you can see because the white matter is deficient, there can be ventricle which can enlarge, there can be asymmetry of the brainstem. All these things are actually part of a tubal neuropathy spectrum. There is one outlier, which is a 2B4A tubal neuropathy. This is again a tubal neuropathy, but this actually presents with a hypomyelination disorder or a hypomyelination disorder with a atrophy of the basal ganglia cerebellum, which is called HABC. So this is also a tubal neuropathy, but actually behaves differently. There can be also associated brain anomalies, but when you see this classically, this the basal ganglia and cerebellar atrophy along with the hypomyelination, you should think of this condition. So now come to the microtubule associated protein abnormalities. Some of them we have already seen. For example, this case is a Dyne C1H1 mutation. All of them are microtubule associated protein. Here you can see that there is some microcephaly, but it was not severe compared to the previous case. But actually you have to measure clinically. You cannot actually infer from MR images. If you see this, there is a Egeria pachygeria complex, which is a Lys encephaly complex, which is more predominant in the posterior aspect of the brain. So when you see very symmetric posterior a predominant Lys encephaly, and when you see the corpus callosum, it is not that abnormal. The brainstem is not that abnormal. Cerebellar hypoplasia is not that abnormal compared to tubal neuropathies, but there can also be significant cerebellar anomalies also associated with the microtubule associated protein abnormalities, especially the relin VLDR and kinesin pathways, which I'll discuss later. So this is corpus callosum is thin. The cerebellar worm is there is maybe slight hypoplasia maybe there. The pons again, there may be some difference in this ratios will be here. But look at the Egeria pachygeria complex, which is more predominant in the anterior part. And the third part, the corpus callosum is thicker, and there is isthmic thinning is not happened. Pons is almost the same height of this milder variations compared to tubal neuropathies. Cerebellar worm is also probably okay. And you can see there is some band heterotopia, especially in the parieto-occipital region. Some people say that frontal is also can be seen in Dyne C1 mutation. So this is a classical one, LIS1 mutation, everybody knows. This is anterior predominant DCX mutation, which is happening in males, and the Dyne C1H1 mutation, which is also described, which has got all these features which can be seen. So if you see this, the mutation, the LIS1 mutation, now that mutation is called a PFA H1 B1, but this one is very common and it is actually commonly used. They are still using this term. This is not obsolete anymore, but the actual the mutation, the pathway mutation is actually found to be PFAH H1 B1. So, but these chromosomal locations are also classical. These are the, well, this one was one of the first mesencephaly mutations described, followed by DCX. And you can see that DCX stands for double cortin, and this is classically produces the double cortex or the band heterotopia, which is seen in females due to DCX mutation. DCX mutation is again producing a band heterotopia most commonly, especially in females. Sometimes very rarely you can see that the LIS1 mutation also can produce band heterotopia, but it will not be as pronounced as that of DCX mutation. So I told about the other microtubule associated proteins, but they can produce a diffuse agaria pachygyria complex, but again they produce this is the cyclin dependent kinase 5, reelin, VLDRL, all of them will produce a significant cerebellar hypoplasia. This is not a proved case. This most probably is again a tubulinopathy, not a microtubule associated protein abnormality, because you see significant microcephaly, corpuscular abnormality, agaria pachygyria complex, and sometimes it will be very difficult to exactly pinpoint what is the mutation, but you have to give a different suggestion so that appropriate genetic testing can be done. Here, I don't think it is actually any of these CDK5, reelin, VLDR, because cerebellar hypoplasia is not very profound. In the all these things, cerebellar hypoplasia will be very, very profound. So if you see this paper from Quantitative Imaging in Medicine and Surgery from 2018, they classified all these things, and all these mutations can produce, which is essentially what I have told previously. But one or two more important features, for example, the ARX mutation, which can produce something like X-LAG or X-linked lissencephaly and abnormal genitalia syndrome. Or any other ARX mutation can produce other syndromes as well. ARX also will produce posteriorly predominant agaria pachygyria, just like LIS1, but you should always look at the genitalia, with the cryptorchidism is there, ambiguous genitalia is there, especially in male patients. ARX mutation can produce this. And the CRAD mutation, even though it is very, very rare, it is very important. This is probably the only lissencephaly mutation which can produce a macrocephaly. All of them others will produce a microcephaly. So if with the clinical findings and specific, you can even sometimes the clinical finding and the clinical history is very important. But if you add to the MR imaging, you can actually suggest probably a specific mutation. So till now, we have actually discussed about all these things. So for example, this case, when I saw the corpus callosum is abnormal, it has got a posterior slant. The genu, the splenium is not, is hypoplastic. It is not thick like the anterior part. You look at the brainstem is definitely abnormal. And if you look at this, the pons is elongated, but the overall size of the cerebral, I mean, the brainstem is not normal. And look at the cerebellar vermis, is hypoplastic. So we are very happy to diagnose, and look at the frontal brain. There is cobblestone lissencephaly. Their white matter is abnormal, ventricular dilated, anterolimbo-dendron capsule is not seen. And I was very happy to call it a tubulinopathy, most likely a tube A1A mutation. That was our report. Even though it was actually done from, these images are from outside, and they all get discussed, and I was very sure that it's going to be a tubulinopathy. But the genetic mutation came again. You can see this microcyst or a pseudocyst. And so I told it is a tube A1A mutation. So I told because there is no muscular dystrophy in this patient, that the presentation is classical for a tubulinopathy. I was very sure that it's a tube A1A mutation, but I was proved wrong. And this was a GPR56 mutation. If you look at this GPR56, this is recently described in brain. The GPR56 is also important in the signaling of the axonal migration. And it is even it is abnormal, the migration will not stop stop by the pia and it will actually over migrate. The same thing which is happening in congenital muscular dystrophy or the same thing which is happening in a tube A1A mutation, it can happen in other pathway mutations as well. So what I'm telling is that several new mutations will be described. From MR imaging alone, you will not be very confident in actually diagnosing. Sometimes you will be finding you will not be surprised by seeing a very new mutation. This is the classical congenital muscular dystrophy. Again, brainstem can be abnormal. Cerebellar vein mass can be hyperplastic. Multiple cystic changes can be seen. And again, supratentorial lissencephaly or more any of the anomalies can be seen, including a cobblestone or a polymicrogyri cortex and cobblestone lissencephaly and an abnormal shape of the brainstem, like a Z or a C-shaped brainstem, which can be seen in Walker-Warburg syndrome. So antenatal MRI is also important, but the problem is that it is very difficult to diagnose many of these lissencephalies before 24 weeks of gestation. So all of them can be diagnosed only after 28 or 29 in experts, never before 27 weeks of gestation. So that is not like they are not coming in the anomaly scan, especially because before 26 or 24 weeks or 21 weeks, the normal brain will look like this. So lissencephalic brain, when it is very difficult before 26 weeks, and usually it will be diagnosed only after 29 weeks of gestation. For example, this is corpus callosum is abnormally formed. This prop spindles, you can see the corpus callosum is not seen clearly, and you can see very difficult, there are features of lissencephaly, especially when it is actually your imaging after 26 weeks of gestation. This is a postal image. You can see there is a significant lissencephaly complex here. And this again, when they looked at antenatally, the genitalia, I don't know whether this is actually legally possible in this country, because looking at an antenatal genitalia is supposed to be a crime. And if you look at this, they actually diagnose this as an ARX mutation. I told that XLAB syndrome, where you see this lissencephaly, especially the posterior predominant lissencephaly with an ambiguous genitalia, the ARX mutation can be very safely diagnosed. So this is a very busy slide, and I will not go into the details. This is exactly what we have actually discussed till now. If you are interested, you can see this paper, very interesting paper, and you can actually, this is a flowchart, how to differentiate between different lissencephaly spectrum. So if you wish to know more about tubulinopathies, there is a very interesting paper again by my friend Fabricio Gonsalves in Topics in Magnetic Resonance Imaging in 2018. And this is the paper which we have just discussed now. So coming to other anomalies, this is we have discussed a lot about the anteroposterior patterning or the craniocaudal or rostrocaudal patterning. Now we talk something about the dorsoventral patterning. So again, due to copyright issues, I will not be showing this video. If you look at this in Neurology Green Journal, if you can take a screenshot, it'll be good, and you can actually go back and see this particular video. And I think many of you might have already seen that video. And this is the classical figure of it, head shaking, which can happen in rhombencephalosynapsis. So rhombencephalosynapsis is again an abnormality of the dorsoventral patterning. There will be fusion of the vestibular hemispheres. There will be no vermis seen, and you can see these white matter fibers bundles traveling across. There can be fusion of the dentate nucleus, which is very well seen on the SW image. Normally T2, you will not see the dentate nucleus separately from the cerebellar white matter, but here you can see the dentate nuclear fusion very well on SWI. So the classical presentation may not be like a figure of eight head shaking. It can also be seen in other conditions like aqueduct of Sylvius occlusion. But when you see this particular shaky head movement, and you should always think of a posterior fossa anomaly. This paper says that there can be fibers. This is what we discussed. The fiber tractography shows the crossing of fibers across. And now there is a quick question. I think we are running short of time. I think I have to show some more cases. We will not go into the, we will not go for a poll. This is, which is the association of rhombencephalosynapsis. So you can type in, but I will not go into the, in the chat box, you can type in what do you think the appropriate answer is. Here, whether it's Verratti-Papp syndrome, Gomez-Lopez-Hernandez syndrome, Vectral holoprosencephaly, none of the above. Actually, it is Verratti-Papp syndrome, which is not associated with the thrombencephalosynapsis is associated with the Joubert syndrome and associated disorders. And the Gomez-Lopez-Hernandez syndrome is one of the commonest association of thrombencephalosynapsis, which the commonest is parietal alopecia. Then there can be trigeminal anesthesia and all. Trigeminal anesthesia, like this, this also, for example, your Möbius syndrome or syndromes like that, where the cranial nerve development is abnormal, or Duane retraction syndrome, you see that these are also abnormalities of the dorsoventral patterning. So this is can be seen in vectoral holoprosencephaly. Everything can be associated with the thrombencephalosynapsis. Now the molar tooth deformity, this is now considered to be a ciliopathy. Previously they were called a Joubert syndrome. Now it's called a Joubert syndrome and related disorders. And you see this abnormal non-crossing of the superior cerebral nerve pedangle, and that's why you see this molar tooth appearance, classical appearance, and but they are not a single syndrome. There can be multiple syndromes associated with this. So now to the another case, that this 3-year-old with feeding difficulty. Look at the brainstem. The medulla has got abnormal shape. The brainstem is abnormally shaped. There is a dorsal projection in the pons. Usually the pontine belly is absent. Usually the projection of the pons should be anterior. But here again, a molar tooth-like appearance is seen. What is this syndrome? And this is the coronal image. The cerebellar hemisphere is also hyperplastic in addition to the vermis. And you can see again there is uncrossing of these fibers of the superior cerebellar pedangle. If it is crossed, you will see a red dot here or a red circle here, which is not seen. These are uncrossed. They are showing something like a molar tooth appearance. So what is this? Is it a Joubert syndrome, or is it a Varadi-Papp syndrome? Is it a pontine tegmental cap dysplasia, dandy-walker malformation, none of the above? Actually, this is a pontine tegmental cap dysplasia. If you see this cap, the dorsally locating, it is not a molar tooth or a syndrome or a Joubert syndrome associated disorder. This is a specific syndrome, and it's actually having a very bad prognosis, especially when the pontine cap is actually very very large or very acutely angled. When this is flattened, it is said that the children will have a better prognosis. When it's actually sharp like this, the prognosis may not be very good. So this is a molar tooth appearance. There are other syndromes like this, when the cerebellar hemispheres are abnormal, the vermis is hyperplastic, and you can see that this is having a dragonfly appearance. The brainstem is also abnormal. This is a pontocerebellar hyperplasia. Different mutations can be associated. There are more than 8 or 9 mutations till now described. I don't know whether it is up to this 2016. I think 8 mutations were described. I think there are more maybe described now. And different mutations depending on the relative hyperplasia of the vermis as well as the cerebellar hemispheres. You can differentiate between CASC and the TSEN54 mutation and all. But these are all developing, and I think more and more cases will be described in the recent future. So coming back to other first of all anomalies, if you see carefully this CT angiography, the cerebellar hemisphere on the right side is hyperplastic. There is very tortuous vessels, and probably many of you might have already actually diagnosed what it is. This is the MR appearance. This is actually what done first MR. You can see that the cerebellar hemisphere, and this, if I give a clue that the patient had a hemangioma of the face on the same side. So now this is a face syndrome. So what is face syndrome? There will be posterior fossa anomalies. The commonest one is a hemispheric cerebellar hyperplasia. Then H stands for the hemangioma, usually on the same side of the cerebellar anomaly. A stands for tortuous, arterial anomalies, which can be tortuous aneurysmal dilatation of the vessels, intracranial vessels. C stands for cardiac anomalies, including coarctation of aorta. And E stands for eye abnormalities, especially colobome of the eye. And sometimes it can be associated with sternal abnormalities, sternal defects. So then it is called a FACES syndrome, P-H-A-C-E-S syndrome. So FACES syndrome. So so it may not be always not all components may be always seen. So even when partially it is seen, It's called a face syndrome. So now coming to one of the last cases is a 4-year-old female with a horizontal gaze palsy. You can see there is an abnormal brainstem. If you see, I will show her brother's 8-year-old brother's MRI, which is essentially the same. If you look at this medulla, it is got an abnormal shape. Usually the pyramid will be more anterior than and laterally, and the smaller will be the olivary nucleus. Here the pyramid is smaller and the pyramid is not crossing, and the olivary nucleus are projecting laterally and they are more prominent. The gracile and cuneate tubercle is not seen and they are flattened out. And the pons has got an abnormal cleft here, and this is the ventricle supratentorial structures are relatively okay. If you look at this, this is the posterior limb of the internal capsule in the internal capsule at the level of the lentiform nucleus. You can see the posterior limb of the internal capsule, which is descending down, which has got a blue color in the DTA. In the brainstem also it is seen, but if you come down to the lower brainstem, especially in the pons, the posterior limb of the internal capsule, the corticospinal tract is not seen. Corticospinal tract is seen up to the midbrain. Here the pons, the corticospinal tract is not clearly seen. And what the medial lemniscus, the dorsal tegmental tracts are actually very prominent, even though the gracile cuneate nuclei are flattened and they are abnormally formed. The transverse pontine fibers are seen, but the corticospinal tract, which should be seen as a blue dot here, which is missing. And not because they are missing, because the transverse pontine fibers are actually very prominent and they are thinned out, and that's why you are not seeing the corticospinal tract. And this is the classical butterfly shaped the medulla, and this is the classical appearance. The corticospinal tract is not seen. The medial lemniscus is very thickened. And what is the likely mutations? If you see this pattern, there is probably only one mutation in the present era which can do this. You can type in your answers, but I'm going to tell you the answer right away. This is a RoBO3 mutation. So why this is RoBO3 mutation? The presentation is, so before going to why, we will see this
nucleus contains 70% of large motor neurons that is going to innervate the right lateral rectus. Okay. So when this nucleus gets stimulated, obviously the right lateral rectus will get contracted. So it will cause the abduction of the right eyeball. It's very clear. But it also contains 30% of small interneurons. These interneurons, as soon as they emerge, they will cross the midline or decussate. I mentioned in a previous video that any crossing midline is called a decussation, because at the similar point, you have the opposite pair crossing the midline. So here, the axons will cross the midline and it will ascend through the MLF, which is interconnecting the vestibular nuclei and the 3, 4, 6 cranial nerve nuclei. So it just gets into the MLF and it ascends up to the left third nerve nucleus. So thus, the abducens nucleus, when it stimulates, it innervates the right lateral rectus, as well as through the MLF, it stimulates the third nerve nucleus. The left MLF is helping to connect the right abducens nucleus and the left oculomotor nucleus. In a similar scenario, the left abducens nerve nucleus gets excited. It will cause contraction of the left lateral rectus. The eyeball gets abducted on the left side, and through the MLF of the right side, the right oculomotor nerve nucleus also gets stimulated, and the eyeball of the right side will be abducted. So left abducens stimulated, leftward gaze, right abducens stimulated, rightward gaze.
So this is what is happening to the patient. This is actually a GPPS, horizontal gaze palsy with progressive scoliosis. And this patient, when they are in the adolescent age, they start progressive scoliosis. And from this appearance alone, we can actually see, even without looking at the patient, we can see this patient most likely will have scoliosis. And this is why this is happening. This is the medial lemniscus, not the medial longitudinal fasciculus we described. We got seen in the previous video. The previous video was from my friend, a very good anatomist, Dr. Doris, and you can actually, this is copyrighted, and I've got a special permission to use this in this presentation. And you can actually search air anatomy, and you can see this in YouTube. And he has got a lot of videos on anatomy, which is actually correlating with the neurology. So we talked about the medial meniscus is getting hypertrophied, but actually the gracile cuneate nucleus are not very well formed. This is the human embryo at the day 56. And you see that this is getting arrested in this stage. That is why the communication between the third nerve nucleus and the sixth nerve nucleus is not proper, because Robo3 is, like I've told, is very important in the axonal pathfinding. So this axonal pathfinding is abnormal. That is why you see this abnormality of the medial longitudinal fasciculus. We are seeing only the medial lemniscus sensory tracts, not the medial longitudinal fasciculus. But because of that, you can see we are not seeing a bulge, which is actually the facial colliculus, which is normally found. It's not there. That's why you see this abnormal shape of the bones. And this is what is happening. So if you see this pattern, the butterfly shaped medulla, and when the patient has got a lateral gaze abnormality, and when they get a post progressive scoliosis, you should always think of this mutation. And why they get scoliosis is basically because of the proprioceptive input is from the sensory tract is not is deficient. That's what is the mechanism of development of progressive scoliosis, especially in the adolescent age in these cases. So there are other mutations which can be predicted from imaging. You can see this superior vermin atrophy, and if you see very carefully, the pons has got an abnormal striation, central hyperintensity, lateral hypointensities, peripheral hypointensities. This patient has got a difficulty in walking and a progressive difficulty in walking. If you see this pattern, you can pretty much be sure that this is one particular condition. I think many of you might have already diagnosed this. This is Arsacs. And again, you can see in this Arsacs, don't see this corticospinal tract in the DTA tractography. You don't see it very well in the pons, even though they are seen very well in the posterior limb of the internal capsule, because the transrespondent fibers are getting very prominent and the corticospinal tract is not very well seen. This is autosomal recessive spastic ataxia of Charlevoix and Saguenay, first described in the French-speaking Canadian province of Charlevoix and Saguenay. But we have also seen a lot of cases, at almost 8 or 9 cases we have seen till now, and with some new mutations. Not all of them are actually Sachs mutations. So now coming to this, the last of the cases, one of the last cases, this we have already told, this is the abnormal shape, which is one of the first cases I have shown in the first slide. And you can see this is not even actually a parenchymal disease, even though the brain is significantly abnormal. All of them is actually due to ACTA2 mutation. ACTA2 mutation basically is a vasculopathy, because the alpha actin, which is not expressed in the brain parenchyma. It is expressed in the smooth muscles and also in the smooth muscles of the brain, the blood vessels. That's why there is a proximal large vessel dilatation and the distal stenosis and a broom-shaped peripheral vessels. And this very classical of ACTA2 mutation. This particular case is not proved of ACTA. Now, recently, some other mutations have also been described, and some challenges on whether this is actually vasculopathy alone or parenchymal interactions, because beta and gamma actins are actually expressed in the brain parenchyma, and there is interaction between the alpha actin and the beta and gamma actin, but alpha actin is definitely not expressed in the brain parenchyma. So this is a very important paper which is published recently by my friend Dr. Felice Iacco from GOSH. And he has actually told that ACTA2 mutation, all these findings, and they have proposed that probably because these vessels are becoming very rigid because of the ACTA2 mutation, the brain is actually getting constrained by the developing rigid vascular system. And these abnormalities are not really due to a parenchymal abnormality, but more studies are actually should be there to prove or disprove this. For example, a fruit which is taking a different shape and it is constrained, the brain parenchyma take a very abnormal shape when the vessels are actually constraining it. So not all, when you see all these abnormalities, I told that the white matter abnormality, abnormal cortical malformations, temporal cysts, brainstem abnormalities, so you tend to think of all these mutations. Some of the acquired conditions like congenital cytomegalovirus virus infection, it is congenital, but it is actually, it's not a genetic disorder. So, you can see that congenital is the disease which is actually present at birth, and a genetic one should have a genetic basis for this. So this is an acquired cause of a congenital disease where you can see that CME, which is also a great mimic. And you can also see multiple microcephaly and Aicardi Goutier syndrome also can produce sometimes like this. And this is this white, multiple white matter hyper intensities with unilateral perisylvian polymicrogyria. You should always think of a congenital CMB or probably other torts like rubella, which can also produce this. And some of the other genetic anomalies which may not produce much of brain malformations. This is a 12-year-old male with generalized dystonia polycythemia, but no KF rings. You can see this T1 hyperintensity of the basal ganglia, the brainstem, the dorsal pons, the cerebellum, especially the dentate nucleus and the white matter, and there is not much of a susceptibility booming. This is a 6-year-old brother. You can see the anterior pituitary is also bright in sagittal image in addition to all these structures. When you see this extensive bright signal, especially the cerebellar and the brainstem in addition to the basal ganglia T1 hyperintensity, and the anterior pituitary is also bright. The posterior pituitary should be bright throughout life, but normally. And the anterior pituitary can be bright up to 2 months of postnatal age, but after that it is 6 years, definitely it's abnormal. And so this is due to a particular disease. We have told that the Wilson's will not produce this extensive T1 hyperintensity, even though lenticular nucleus hyperintensity can produce. This is actually hypermanganesemia due to a particular mutation, SLC38N gene mutation, because this patient also produced, polycythemia. Here, this particular patient, the serum manganese was very much elevated, and the SLC38N gene mutation was also proved. But other mutations like SLC39814, SLC38N, both can produce severe movement disorders. But SLC38N also produces polycythemia. This other mutation.
Yeah, Deepak, why is it stopped?
I think, sir, timer
issue.
No, sir, exit ho gaya shayad unka network something.
Acha. Shall I call him? Push leti hu. Dr. Bijoy is coming on again. We'll just wait a couple of minutes for him. I think he had a connectivity issue. He'll be back soon. Okay. Yeah, sir is back. Yeah. Sir, you're muted.
So, can you see the slide?
Yeah. No, you have to share your screen, sir.
Okay, yeah. Sir. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Sorry for that. So till this slide, could you see that? And here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So other mutations, especially when this is very important, if you see this hypertrophic olivary degeneration in a child with a suspected mitochondrial disease, for example, it's a POLG mutation, it's a MIRAS syndrome. This is very important finding. Many of the times it will be missed. And if you miss this and the child has got seizures, and if you start valproate, child is going to die because of liver failure. So the only thing which can save the child probably is actually a liver transplantation. So this is very important. And a hypertrophic olivary degeneration can be seen in mitochondrial, in addition to other causes of which whatever is causing actually affecting the Guillain-Mollaret triangle, in addition to subtle changes. So when you see this, you always think of a POLG mutation. And when you see the subthalamic nuclear involvement, dorsal brainstem involvement without much of a basal ganglia involvement, again, you have to think of a mitochondrial disease, Leigh's disease due to SERFN mutation. So all these subtle changes in the brainstem can actually give you a lot of clue. So these are my references, and this is not a complete list of references, and we'll come to the last case. What is the most appropriate diagnosis? This is probably you can actually write the diagnosis. You see the abnormal brainstem here. I actually see the coronal images, and this is again an abnormal midbrain here. And what is the diagnosis? Is it a diencephalic mesencephalic junction dysplasia, or is it an INAD? Is it a microtubule associated protein abnormality? Is it a tubulinopathy, or none of the above? What do you think? Dr. Suhasini, do you have some answers coming in?
I'll just check, sir. Okay.
So if
A, people have, I've got one A and one D.
Yeah, so it could be. So because if you go back, this is the diencephalon is the one which is abnormal, and this can be classically seen in diencephalic mesencephalic junction dysplasia, but the history is very important. In this case, patient presented with the postural hypotension, not with the seizures and congenital anomalies, and this is none of the above. This is intracranial hypotension. So this is intracranial hypotension can produce both the peripheral findings as well as sometimes the central herniation of the brain can come, and this can mimic diencephalic mesencephalic junction dysplasia. For example, this is these are two published cases of diencephalic mesencephalic junction dysplasia. This is a forked midbrain. This is a publication from Barkowitz's original article in 2009. You can see it, how classically it mimics an intracranial hypotension. So it is very difficult sometimes to differentiate. And the clinical history is very, very important. And without clinical history, if you are going to look at the images, I think you are going to make a great mistake. So for example, if you diagnose, these are entirely different things, but they can have a very similar MR appearance. That's why I showed this. The take-home message is that a careful examination of the posterior fossa structures may be a clue to the specific mutation, and imaging genomics is coming up in a big way. And I would like to thank all my colleagues who have supplied. And if you're interested in knowing more about neuroimaging in 5 minutes, there is a YouTube channel. I have a YouTube channel. And I would like to thank you all again.
Thank you, sir, for that excellent presentation. We do have some questions. I'll start with the, okay. So I think you've already answered this in your talk, how to differentiate tubulinopathies and actinopathies. So I think we don't need to go into that. But there's one question with Dr. Udani. Isn't GPR56 usually causes bilateral frontoparietal polymicrogyria rather than cobblestone? Listen carefully. I also had this question because we classically associate GPR56 with frontoparietal.
Yes, these mutations, both the polymicrogyria as well as cobblestone lissencephaly are post-migrational events. So these are very important in the formation of how that after migration, how that neurons are getting organized. So it can be produced by both. Sometimes the problem is that some of these cobblestone lissencephaly and polymicrogyria complexes, may not be very, very easy to diagnose and from MR imaging alone. They will be reported interchangeably sometimes. When there is classical cobblestone lissencephaly, nobody is going to miss that. So I'm not telling that GPR56, maybe that is a common, I'm not very sure about that. Why I showed that case that because it exactly mimics the 2BAV1A mutation with the frontal predominant cobblestone lissencephaly.
So then there's a question that is it advisable to do a tractography in all posterior fossa malformations?
So if you are actually doing some research, I think it is very important to do tractography, because a lot of papers are actually coming up in posterior fossa tractography, and people have actually, what we look at basically as assigning, for example, I told about the medial lemniscus, and may not be always true. And I told that this is actually the corticospinal tract is not seen. You can do actually fiber tractography and see whether this is a split corticospinal tract or is an absent corticospinal tract. And all these things are gaining importance. And I think the importance of DTA is only going to increase in the coming years with the advent of more and more phenotypic-genotypic correlations.
So one question, the case you showed which had superior vomus atrophy and inferior vomus hypoplasia, what was the diagnosis in that patient?
The case which I showed, that was that the same case, similar case like what I told this Arsax, this thing. But I told, initially I thought that inferior vermin hypoplasia can be definitely differentiated from a superior vermin atrophy, but SNIA has actually showed that when there is atrophy, it is very difficult to predict whether the hypoplasia was there initially unless you have serial follow-up.
Okay. So both can coexist or
coexist? Yeah, coexist. Okay. And sometimes it will be very difficult to differentiate. And when there is atrophy, it is not possible to say that hypoplasia was associated initially.
So one question, as a clinician, when we see these malformations, are these abnormalities very specific for the particular gene, or like you showed the cases, we thought it tubuloplethy was the most likely cause and it turned out to be GPR56. So
should we go for a
whole exome sequencing as we usually do, or is it worthwhile to go for the particular, can we pinpoint the gene and just look for that abnormality? That
the answer is that right now it is not possible, because our understanding, our imaging correlates are very limited, and there can be significant overlap from phenotypic to genotypic significant overlap on that. So but it is very important to find out at least what you are actually, which pathway you are actually suspecting, so that we can actually do the whole exome sequencing is a good idea, but sometimes even that can miss new novel mutations. So the problem is many cases we are not getting a specific mutation in many cases. So how would you account for that? Or some mutations which are of never published previously, what is they report it as the significance is not known. So I think more and more research should happen in this, and I'm sure that artificial intelligence and radiomics will come in this picture, because there will be very subtle changes which can be picked up by computers, which a human eye currently is not possible to pick up, and which can differentiate between these subtle changes, mutations, because everything is a different pathway. Everything will have some telltale evidence on MR, which we are actually generalizing to certain extent. For example, I may not be able to differentiate between a subtle hypoplasia, which is associated with an atrophy, but the computer may, if you see a lot of cases.
Okay. So I think Dr. Udani was here and Dr. Vinayan is also here. Dr. Vinayan, do you want to ask something specific? So I have unmuted you. I unmuted sir also. But I think I can't see them anymore. Okay. Thank you so much, sir. I think for that excellent talk and those resources are also very useful.
Okay.
And we learned a lot today. And if we have any difficult cases, we'll definitely get in touch with you, because these are complicated patients.
Thank you.
Your inputs are very
good. I would like to see cases, because that will actually improve my understanding also.
Yes.
And not that I'm going to diagnose everything, but these are all proved. Most of them are proved cases. Some of them are not proved. So, but the constantly new findings are being described. So it's a very, very dynamic field. I think it is a very interesting field as well.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you very much for this invitation.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir. The pleasure is all ours, and we hope to see you soon again.
Thank you.
Maybe after a month or so. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Bye, sir. Good night.